If you have been watching this program, I'm sure you're no stranger to the horrific cases of defilement, incest, various forms of physical abuse and the likes. Our victim story segment has showcased many survivors. We have also paraded suspects and persons convicted for acts of violence against persons. But if this is your first time tuning in, this is NAPTIP On The Move, and I am Emmanuel Okeke. Thank you for joining us. Our package today will uncover the history of the Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act, the provisions, innovations, and challenges. It promises to be very enlightening. Stay with us.
Implementation of the Violence Against Persons Act of 2015 is part of the mandate of NAPTIP.
The VAP Act is very wide. There's a series of offenses that are constituted as violence against persons under the VAP Act. And these acts include rape, physical injury, genital mutilation or circumcision, gang rape, incest, so many, you know, anything that causes bodily harm or even psychological harm to a person is considered as violence against the person. And NAPTIP has been mandated to administer the VAP Act, and we work with other law enforcement agencies and other sister agencies like the Nigerian Police Force, Ministry of Women Affairs, Ministry of Health, and some federal government parastatals as well to implement the VAP Act.
Joy Ezilo, a law professor and foremost lecturer on women and children law in Nigeria, a former United Nations rapporteur on human trafficking and founder of Women Aid Collective and Tamar Sark, speaks on the processes and challenges in enacting the act.
The VAP Act started, it was a very long process, I must say, almost 13 to 14 years of work. We had the first draft at the inception of the Fourth Republic, and following that we didn't make much progress to that end of the Fourth Assembly, and we now went back to Strategy Board, because part of the complaint was people were saying that it was so violence against women, there are a lot of violence in society and everybody required to be covered. And I agree with the concern when we looked at the reason behind it, that violence affects also men and women, and especially little boys. Little boys are also raped, they are victims of sexual violence, they are victims of physical abuse. So we set up a committee that we look at totality of violence in society. How do we not only just criminalize it, but protect victims as well as ensure that we prevent it? So we set up this committee working closely with DFID, then under what they call Security, Justice and Growth. So it was the then Federal Ministry of Justice, and then I was invited to chair. I acted as a chairperson of that drafting committee. So with that drafting committee, we worked with the Federal Ministry, the drafts people there, and we had even an international expert, and we came up with a draft. That was 2005. So 2005, 2006, 2007, we had a different version. The version that now became comprehensive, and it was titled Elimination of Violence Act. We started pushing for this bill. It's not easy. It will make progress, then it will fail at the end of the day. And then the rule was that once it fails, you have to start afresh. So each time we're starting de novo, each time we have a new assembly. But after the amalgamation, it got that steam. I think there was more support for it, because now everybody have seen that the bill is comprehensive, is holistic, is really looking at gender, as it affects women, men, boys, girls, and it was all embracing and it was acceptable. But that doesn't mean that legislative hurdle was there, that we still have to follow through the process. And we followed and we sustained advocacy, I must say, by gender activists, women's group, international organization, and very many supportive men who were able to push it through.
Implementation of the VAP Act also has challenges with national applicability.
There were a number of issues that were being raised. Mostly the resistance was around the fact that under, because it's a federal system, that every state has a right to have their own criminal law. So the initial resistance was, take it back to the state. State can make provisions for in their penal system as it will apply. But we needed something at federal level that would have also left FCT. So in the end, the compromise was they would limit the application. There was one of the occasions they had to engage with all the attorney generals from all the federation. They said, okay, we can have it limited application to federal capital territory. And all the other states will go ahead and adopt it, because then the federal government cannot in this area make a legislation that will be applicable nationwide, given the nature of our fiscal federalism we practice. So that was why we had this bill, this act, finally limited to FCT.
Professor Ezelo then shed light on why NAPTIP was chosen to implement the act.
Whenever you make a law, a new law, one must think of the cost implication. And initially we recommended commission, but if you have a commission, it's a whole lot of new expenses and we don't want anything that would delay the bill. So we said, okay, we should have already existing body. That's how it ended up being NAPTIP. That was an agency that was chosen to implement it. NAPTIP has already done a lot of prosecution. They have also good track record with regard to prosecution and conviction of cases and working in related area, because human trafficking is a part of violence against women. Issue of labor and related matter, even as it affects children, are already part of things that are criminalized. And that's why we said, let an already existing institution that is empowered by law, that's already doing very well in that area of competence, they can take this as added on. So finally, it was also accepted.
NAPTIP, in implementing the VAP Act, provides psychosocial support and shelter services to victims.
The shelter we have is called Halfway Home. It is shelters meant to protect these victims, you know, so that we can have access to them. We have a department called Counseling and Rehabilitation Department, where we have counselors, psychologists, who take care of the emotional stability, physiological stability of these victims, you know, to have them stable, you know, mentally, and be able to tell us the story of what happened to them. So I will tell you that our shelter is one of our strongest points in combating crime. Because once a crime takes place, we are able to rescue the victim from the scene of crime, separate them from their violators. By so doing, issue of threats will not arise any longer, because they threaten some of these victims not to talk. So but once that victim is in our shelter, then we have separated them from their violator. So they will now be stable and they feel happy.
Provisions of the VAP Act is all-encompassing with innovations.
This bill is comprehensive. It introduced certain innovation that wasn't there before. For example, in terms of definition of rape, under the penal system before, it was so gender specific. It's an act that can only be committed by a man on a woman. But with VAP, it expanded that definition to even cover our realities. Reality is that boys are sexually abused, that they are raped as well, they are victims. So in effect, men are also victims of rape. And then it's not an offense that can be committed only by a man against a woman. And importantly, again, to introduce minimum sentencing. Because part of the problem with regard to rape is that people just commit such a heinous crime that carries life imprisonment, and attempted rape is 14 years. It's a felony, heavily punished under the law. But you see people get away with life sentencing. Some 6 months, some suspended 1 year, if that is when it is proved. And many people don't, are still not sensitized with what action to take. Immediately they are raped, they will just wash away all the evidence by the time the doctor is seeing them. Or they may not even have gone to doctor, the forensic aspect lacking. But under this VAP Act, we now have innovation in this area.
The Act, which categorizes sexual and gender-based violence, also provides for maintaining a sexual offenders register.
We also have innovation in the area of maintaining offenders register, so that you know sexual offenders. If their name enter that register, it's very important, ideally, in civilized society. If you're trying to move into a neighborhood and you have children, you have to inquire, are there sex offenders in this area? They will tell you. And they will tell you so that you know how you know people who are predatory, pedophiles, they will know how to reform, then you know how to care for your family.
Professor Joy Ezilo then highlighted other areas covered by the Act.
It introduced other aspects because gender-based violence had different aspects. It had the physical, the sexual violence, the issue of economic violence, the issue of emotional violence, and harmful traditional practices. Acid attack, the issue of inheritance, right, is covered. Financial deprivation. And this deprivation is very serious because some of the cases we see, you see people abandoning their family. There are other areas, even political violence, for example, in generally, because it's also covering violence as it affects the entire society, is also there. It's even covered stalking, which is another form that is happening. Stalking by phone, by social media, all of this that is happening. That's why I said this act is innovative.
The ROLAC program of the British Council, sponsored by the European Union, has also come on board.
The Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act brings together all the different pieces of legislation that we have that talks about violence, not just on women, but also on every other person. You know, if you look at the punishment sections for those laws, they are quite stiff, they are quite high, unlike we have in our criminal or penal courts. The second one is that apart from sanctions as we have them in the law, there are also provisions for services to help those that are victims of violence. There are services for counseling, and the law also provides for monitoring of those service providers to ensure that whatever they provide is of quality and that is appropriate for those that need those services. And perhaps lastly is the fact that there is one central coordinating body. Luckily for us, NAPTIP has been identified by the law as the agency to coordinate the implementation of the VAP Act. So given all these factors, you know, we thought that this would be an appropriate legislation to support implementation.
Some of the intents of the Act include:
it prevents violence and sanctions it to serve as a deterrent to people who may want to commit that. It is in the interest and the best interest of society, in the best interest of the family, in the best interest of Nigeria, that we bring reduced violence to the barest minimum.
A word of advice from NAPTIP.
To the public, we want to tell you that it's no longer business as usual. Gone are the days where people's rights are violated, you know, with impunity. If you see any form of violence against any person, man, woman, boy, anybody, girl, children, please report to NAPTIP. Work with us so to ensure that we bring a stop to inhuman treatment against human beings generally.
With such passionate vanguards fighting for a violent-free Nigeria, the VAP Act has indeed come to stay.
The Violence Against Persons Prohibition Act, known as the VAP Act, aims to eliminate violence in private and public life, prohibit all forms of violence against persons, provide maximum protection and effective remedies for victims, while ensuring that offenders are adequately punished. NAPTIP implements this act, and for all victims of violence, be it domestic, physical, economic and psychological violence, female genital mutilation, incest, harmful substance attacks, rape, child abandonment, and so on. We call on you to take your destiny into your own hands by reporting to NAPTIP, and we assure you that justice will be served.
Report all cases of violence against persons to these hotlines: 0703 000203, 080 2255 627847. NAPTIP, ensuring a human trafficking and violence-free nation.
If you don't take away anything from this episode, please remember what to do in the case of a rape. Get immediate medical tests carried out for valuable evidence so the rapist is locked away for life. NAPTIP Events is next. Keep watching. Officials of the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, UNODC, led by the outgoing officer in charge of the Nigerian office, Elizabeth Beyer, recently visited the agency's headquarters in Abuja. Elizabeth Beyer commended the collaboration with NAPTIF so far and spoke on new UNODC projects in Nigeria as it relates to human trafficking.
We come here always smiling because really the work, and I want to thank you, that we do with NAPTIF, it's really a joy, really, in terms of the collaboration that we have with your team, thanks to all your team. And in that sense, we have been very, very proactive to do a lot of project development. As you know, our last EU project has expired. And on this phase of the project development side, we are very happy today to share with you on a new project. It's a small project. There's two aspects that are of interest to you. One, we would like to propose under this to establish a judicial research center in that sense in your central area or in any location you would propose. And the other area of interest is the activities are in the area of training for the legal side, prosecution, judges, as well as also on awareness raising, but the focus is at the state levels.
Welcoming the outgoing officer in charge, Director General of NAPTIF, Damjili Okazandi, shed light on the existing collaboration and made suggestions towards better operations and cooperation.
I'm very happy about the level of cooperation and collaboration we've been having with yourselves. Awareness raising for me is number one. We need to carry out very serious awareness campaigns all over rural communities, even in the urban cities these days. In addition to training of prosecutors and judges, I think investigators, because if they bungle up the investigation, trust me, there's nobody to prosecute. So I think these are very key people that we need to really focus our attention on if we really want to get prosecutions going on.
It was an interactive meeting, as some directors of NAPTIF also shared their views. Partnership with stakeholders is one of NAPTIF's five-pronged approach deployed in fulfillment of its mandate. The Anti-Human Trafficking Network recently held its fourth stakeholders meeting at the International Organization for Migration in Lagos. The meeting, which was aimed at tackling human trafficking and irregular migration in vulnerable communities through consistent awareness creation and fostering stronger collaboration networks amongst government and non-governmental organizations, was chaired by the NAPTIF Zonal Commander, Daniela Tokolo. Members of the Anti-Human Trafficking Network renewed their commitment to collaborate in the fight against human trafficking and irregular migration. The Anti-Human Trafficking Network in Lagos State is an initiative of NAPTIF, which is facilitated by the Salvation Army Nigeria under its Community Awareness and Recovery Project to prevent and reduce the impact of human trafficking in Nigeria. The Director General of NAPTIF, Damjili Okazandi, and her team recently received delegates from the Nigerian Institute of Public Relations, NIPR, led by its chairman, Dr. Adetayo Hastrop, at the agency's headquarters in Abuja. Speaking on the purpose of their visit, the chairman, Dr. Dita Hastrop, shed light on the background of NIPR.
We are charged with the responsibility of promoting professionalism and excellence in corporate communication and regulating the activities of all populations professionals in Nigeria in line with the ethics of the profession of public relations. One of the reasons for our commitment is to basically renew our existing relationship with the organization to collaborate with the organization on areas of mutual benefits.
Welcoming the delegation, the Director General of NAPTIF expressed interest in partnering with the Institute.
In NAPTIF, we carry out what we call the 5P strategy, and partnership is one of the 5Ps. We are empowered to partner with every relevant stakeholder in the fight against human trafficking. And I can tell from your presentation that you're a very relevant stakeholder in the fight against human trafficking. And we are ready and willing to partner with your institute.
She also advised NIPR to work with NAPTIF towards embarking on a national orientation of the Nigerian youths as regarding human trafficking.
A lot of the youths are victims of their upbringing, unfortunately. And so they think that anything outside Nigeria is the best. They do not realize that there is no place like home, and the fact that even abroad, things are not as rosy as they think they are. I would like to embark on a massive awareness in the whole of Nigeria, in all 36 states of the Federation, with
the National Orientation Agency and NACTIP, as regards human trafficking, targeting all the youths, to, you know, tell them to have the faith in Nigeria and to know that there is no place like home.
Partnership is one of the agency's five-pronged approach towards eradicating human trafficking from Nigeria. The Director General of NAPTIP, Dame Jili Akadonli, recently attended the Anti-Slavery Week program at the House of Commons in the United Kingdom. The program, which is organized by the Africans Unite Against Child Abuse Africa, AFRUCA, was hosted by Meg Helia, a Member of Parliament and Chairman of the House of Commons Select Committee on Public Accounts. Delivering the keynote address, Dame Jili Akadonli highlighted the activities of the agency and stressed on the need for closer collaboration. NAPTIP also signed a Memorandum of Understanding with AFRUCA on cooperation bordering on victims protection. The AFRUCA meeting had about 120 participants from different countries representing government and non-governmental organizations. The Director General of NAPTIP also featured on Arise Television in London, where she discussed issues of human trafficking and violence against persons. The Swiss government recently organized a training on correct identification and provision of support for rescued victims in Switzerland. NAPTIP's Director of Research and Program Development, Godwin Mocha, represented the Director General. Discussions with the Swiss Department of Human Security was focused on supporting NAPTIP to develop strong policy framework and blueprint for effective national response to human trafficking. Godwin Mocha also had a meeting with the Nigerian ambassador to Switzerland, His Excellency Baba Madugu. The zonal commander of NAPTIP in Oshobo Osun State, Agaran Ganu Alao, was also in attendance. It's now time for the victim story segment. Don't go away.
I'm from Nasarawa. I'm 14 years old. Why I'm here in Sheta is because of my madam beats me. What I do is because her child now carry broom, can't put in the fire. I wanted to collect the broom from her. Me and her were dragging the broom. Then the broom, the hot broom now touch her eye. Then she now wound small. Then my madam now come back and saw the wound. She now asked me what happened to her child. And I tell her that we put stuff. Then she now carry broom I can put in the fire. I collect it. Then while dragging it down, the fire now touch her eye. Then she now tell me that I'm lying, that is not what I do. That I carry the fire straight and burn her child eye. Then I not tell her no. She said, I will see what she will do to me. Then I not tell her I'm sorry. She said no. She will come lock me in store. And she locked me in the store. She carry gas and put the fire and put two knives on the fire. And she tell me to remove all my clothes. I remove all my clothes. Then she not carry the hot knife and put for my bottom. And she put for my bottom. Then she started beating me. I was having wounds all over my body. She broke my head with sticks, turning very stick. From that day, I can't walk. That day, all my body was just wound. From that day was Tuesday. And she beat me from that Tuesday. I stayed for my house till Saturday. That one Saturday was 15. Then she went to church. She went to church, she will come back in the evening. That is the day I leave her house and meet one woman that, please ma, I need to go. That this woman is looking at me, I can't live in her house. That I want to go, what she do to me? I cannot stay in her house. I now show the woman the wound that she give me. The woman now call one man. That let the woman, she take me to police station. Then the man now say no, that he is going to call NAPTIP people. They now call the mother on the phone. That let her come to his office. He now tell him the name of the office. She now say okay, she leave the church immediately. Then they now take me to this shelter place. I just tell them thank you. Because if I'm with her, that one day She tell me that if she kill me, my parents will not know where I am, that I'm in Abuja, and my auntie will not know that they kill me. She can use me and make money. She can just kill me and carry me and come and bury me somewhere. Nobody will ask for me.
For more inquiries and support, or to report cases of suspected human trafficking and violence against persons, call NAPTIP hotlines on 0703-000203 or 0800-2255-627847 or email info@naptip.gov.ng. Visit our website www.naptip.gov.ng. Follow us on our social media platforms at NAPTIP Nigeria and watch our videos on YouTube.
This is where we draw the curtain on today's episode. We await your calls, text messages and emails. The NAPTIP iReport app is there as well. So do your part and report cases of violence against persons, human trafficking and child abuse to NAPTIP. Join us again, same time next week. I am Imanella Okeke. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.